Among the most illustrious names in the history of the European civilization, the name of Alexander the Great, King of Macedonia, Asia, the master of half of the civilized world at that time, is perhaps one of the most remarkable. And it is because his great achievements are still the subject of many discussions, the source of controversy for both historians, experts in the field, and those who are interested in the life and endeavors of the great man. Well, his life was rather short. He died 3 weeks away from his 33rd birthday in Babylon, Persia, the great empire he had conquered with his Greco-Macedonian army. And there are a lot of books, monographs, and films which were made or written devoted to his great achievements. And still, over the last 2,400 years, he's towering over the rest of the mortals as the one who is very often considered to be the living symbol of the heroic in ancient Greece and Europe on the whole. But before we try to analyze the circumstances that eventually brought him to glory and fame all over the civilized world, we'll have to dwell upon the specificity of the heroic in ancient Greece. And here I have to say that unlike the Christian era, in ancient Greece, in the pagan Greco-Roman world, the heroic was not associated with any type of morals. It did not contain any moral connotation. A hero was the man who was motivated in his actions by the specificity of the Olympic religion, of which I will have to say you a few words. It's very well known that within the context of the Olympic religion and Greek mythology at large, an individual did not have a bright and promising prospect in the afterlife, and so had to realize his ambitions while he was still alive. His major stimulus in his everyday life was to imitate the Olympic gods, who embodied might and glory at its fullest possible extent. So a hero was a man who did not consider himself limited by any restrictions of the ordinary. In his everyday activities, he was desperately trying to overcome any limitations and restrictions of that sort and become a superhuman. So the divine was the major object of his endeavor. And since he was not bound by any moral limitations, he considered himself free. So freedom is something very important, really substantial for the proper understanding of the nature of the heroic in the Greco-Roman world, because without freedom of action, freedom of ambition, one can hardly ever imagine a man having the slightest opportunity to become a true hero. So drawing oneself from the context of the ordinary, common life was something that strongly motivated a man in his attempt to be on a par with the divine and immortal Olympic gods. So hero is a transitory phenomenon, a transitory entity, someone who stems from the world of the ordinary and common, someone who originates from the world of the mortals, but aspires to the divine and eventually becomes one of the immortals if he eventually reaches his goal, realizes his ambition at its most full and possible extent. Well, the most important moment about the heroic in ancient Greece, to my mind, is to note the fact that a hero very often was in a state of conflict with the ordinary, because without tearing oneself apart from the ordinary, one could not ever hope to reach the divine. So it was that state of a conflict that provoked sometimes some sort of condemnation on the part of the commoners and their sense of envy, which seems to be absolutely inevitable when we try to analyze the phenomenon in the context of the Greek civilization. Well, why an individual might be so strongly motivated to reach the divine, to become one of the gods? Well, this question would appear rather strange or perhaps unacceptable to those who think within the Christian tradition and who belong to the Christian tradition in the first place, because from the Christian standpoint, an individual should not even think about being on a par with the divine, should temper his temptation to overcome all the boundaries, all the limitations of everyday life, and come closer to the celestial world of the divine entities, angels, archangels. So it is the fight against any temptation or passion of that sort that seemingly lies in the very core of the Christian understanding of the relations between mortals and immortals, between man and God. But unlike the Christian attitude towards this problem, the ancient Greek approach to it well, seems to be quite different, and it was quite different indeed, because a man in the Greco-Roman cultural context did not consider himself limited or bound by any obligations to the divine. The Olympic gods did not give him any moral message, did not require any love or something close to love from him, which is exactly the case in the Christian tradition, as you very well know. The Olympic gods embodied might, glory, power at its fullest, and man was expected to imitate the Olympic gods exactly in those aspects. So it was quite natural to imagine the situation in which a man who was definitely dissatisfied with his everyday life and mortality in the first place, as well as the bleak prospect of the afterlife, could have a certain impulse that would urge him to overcome all the boundaries of the imperfect world of the mortals in order to come closer to the world of the divine entities, the Olympic gods. Well, since gods did not give him any moral commandments, like it is again the case in the biblical tradition, you very well know about that, a man was not tied by any moral obligations. Very often he was in a state of a rather tough competition with the divine, and it was that very competition that stimulated his activities to a large extent. So we find the confirmation of that in the biography of Alexander and his great exploits. Another moment which is apparently very important there is that inevitably a hero coming into a state of a conflict with the everyday ordinary life, common lifestyle in general, tries to destroy his immediate surroundings. Well, that conflict, that tough competition, very often results in a clash between a hero-to-be and those who are around them. So their sufferings and their death is apparently something that comes inevitably as a result of that clash. So through the destruction of his surroundings, through the destruction of the system of values, limitations and restrictions imposed on our potential hero by our people around, he tries to create something that would act and serve as the pedestal for his own glory and might, for his grandeur. He tries to create a reality of his own which is to replace the old world. It is something I consider very significant for the proper understanding of the heroic in Greece, because without the construction of a principally new reality, a principally new world that would act as the altar to the grandeur and might of a hero, he can hardly hope to leave any memory of his great endeavors and exploits in the hearts and minds of the generations to come. So it is the memory of the generations to come that is to be fixed in marble and Well, that is to be fixed in the creation of a hero's own hand, be it a marble temple or a royal palace or numerous statues devoted to the hero that he tries to reach his goal through. So it is very important to understand why memory was so valuable to a hero in ancient Greece. Since he knew very well that his mortal nature was hardly going to be changed by his great exploits, and as it was exactly the case with Achilles, Odysseus, Heracles, and many other great heroes of the past, legendary, mythological past. A great hero, even despite his achievements, even in spite of his great exploits, was still going to die because his mortal nature was hardly going to be changed anyhow. Well, he knew very well, and he pinned all his hopes on that. But the only chance for him to remain, anyhow, not directly, perhaps not physically, of course, although physical immortality was something that had been reached by Heracles through his 12 great labors, and we know that very well. Eventually, he was given the unprecedented reward by his father's use. He became one of the Olympic gods about immortality. But still, and since the hero knew very well that his nature was not going to be changed and he was going to die no matter how great his exploits might be, well, he knew very well that remaining in the memory of the generations to come was practically the only award he could hope for, he could pin his hopes on. And he tried to reach that award by all means. Well, he knew very well that the memory of his great deeds should be as long-living as possible. It should not be consigned to oblivion. It should not be clean forgotten by the generations which would follow him. So the greater an exploit might be, the stronger, the deeper the memory of that exploit would turn out to be in the end. That is why great heroes of Greece and Rome were so strongly motivated to do something really unprecedented, something that would go beyond human imagination, something that would make a deep impression on the hearts and minds of both their contemporaries and people to follow. That stance, rather, was also stipulated to a large extent by the fact that the span of human life at that time was rather short. People did not live long, partly because of the numerous wars, partly because of the everlasting conflicts and the very state of competition that acquired the unprecedentedly high extent of self-mobilization from an individual, which sometimes was quite exhausting. In ancient Greece, particularly at the peak of its might and glory in the 5th century BC, as we very well know, the competitiveness, the level of competitiveness was unprecedentedly high, which could not but stimulate quite a great deal the attempts of an individual to impress by all means. Sometimes it would turn out to be rather peculiar, if not eccentric, particularly in the fields of arts, well, where the competition I have spoken about was underway quite strongly and manifests itself quite strongly in many ways. Well, but as far as the battlefield was concerned, warfare was indeed the most promising area of human activities in which an individual could hope to reach, well, glory and might and public acclaim in the easiest possible way and the quickest one, which is very important. Here I have to say a few words about the political situation that existed in Greece in the 4th century BC, because without the proper understanding of the political background at that time, we can hardly properly explain to ourselves the phenomenon of Alexander the Great. Perhaps you know that Greece in the late 5th, early 4th centuries BC was in a state of deep economic and political crisis. Well, it was caused by the by an increase in the exploitation of slaves of all kinds in Greek economy, and free farmers and free craftsmen could not compete with slaves because slavery was widespread and slaves were very cheap. Practically in every Greek household, in Greek city-states, slaves were used. Excessively sometimes, and free farmers and free craftsmen went bankrupt en masse because of that, which could not but cause quite a great deal of public turmoil in Greek city-states at that time, destabilizing the political and economic situation, as a result of which Greek was rapidly sliding down into a state of widespread political disarray and serious social upheavals, as a result of which the clash between the most powerful city-states at that time, Athens and Sparta, occurred. The Peloponnesian War that lasted several decades exhausted Greece and created the atmosphere of chaos in Greek city-states at that time. So Greece found itself on the brink of collapse, complete and total disarray. So the only chance for the Greek city-states to save themselves from the social and political chaos was to turn their gaze northward to the kingdom of Macedonia, where the rule of King Philip II at that time, well, helped quite a lot to stabilize the situation in the country, unite aristocratic clans, nobility, the upper class of Macedonian society around the throne, strengthen the political power of the Macedonian monarch, and reorganize the army, which was a very important support of the king's rule. So his great plan was to march eastward. The empire of the Persians at that time was the grandest country, the vast empire indeed. It included vast territories in Egypt, Middle East, Asia. It bordered India, and lots and lots of tribes were united by the power of great kings of Persia. The Persian Empire was, of course, the richest state at that time, so Philip II could hope to not only take revenge on the Persians, but also gain huge wealth there as a result of his victory, the victory he hoped for. So his ambition was to unite the Greeks around Macedonia and create an unprecedentedly strong army and lead that army against the Persians. And he had taken an unprecedentedly painstaking effort to prepare that march against Persia. And everything was apparently ready for the start of the great military exploit. But an unlucky event in his life occurred. Bad luck, to be more exact. He was taking part in the wedding ceremony of his daughter, when, as a result of a palace conspiracy, he was killed by one of his bodyguards, and the sources say his ex-lover boy, whose name's Pausanias. Well, in all probability, while the sources which are available for professional historians nowadays make it possible to assume that Alexander knew about the conspiracy and about the intention of the participants in the conspiracy to kill his father. Anyway, it was not necessary for him. What was really necessary for him just to make all the arrangements as a result of which his father would die, which was exactly the case. As to Olympias, the ex-queen, and Alexander's mother, her interest in removing Philip II in order for her eldest son to take the throne, her interest in that was quite apparent, and there was hardly any doubt in any Macedonian at that time that she had her say in arranging that conspiracy against her husband, the king. Well, here we are to start talking about Alexander's biography, because his birth and his upbringing and everything that is associated with the events of his earlier childhood, as well as his relation with his father and mother, are very important for proper understanding of the origins of the heroic in the life of that man, as well as the heroic in general in ancient Greece, to my mind. I intend to use the biography of Alexander as an example that would illustrate how a man could become a hero in ancient Greece and what was necessary for a mortal to become an immortal in the end, at least in the hearts and minds of those who were around him and those generations who were to come. The birth of Alexander the Great is surrounded by lots and lots of myths, legends, and rumors. Historians say that on the day of his birth, two eagles sat on the roof of the royal palace in Pella, the capital of Macedonia, which was interpreted by priests at that time as a sign that a royal prince born was going to be the master of the two parts of the civilized world, the East and the West. On that very day, his father, King Philip II, received the news from Olympia, where his chariot had gained victory in the chariot race, and he became an Olympionic victor at the Olympiad. Plus, of course, his army gained victory on that very day over some barbaric tribe in the north. So the combination of those three victories made it possible for the priests in Macedonia to assume that the prince, newly born prince, was going to be a great victor. He was going to outstrip his own father, to surpass his great achievements in the end, which would turn out to be exactly the truth. Well, I have to emphasize the fact that since the very beginning of Alexander's life, there were so many great legends and myths around them, and those legends were at least partly stimulated by the talks of his own mother, Olympias. Well, that queen is really a remarkable woman. Well, we have to say a few words about her as well. She was a princess from Epirus, the northern province of Greece, and she traced her royal lineage to Achilles himself and felt really proud of that. Well, the sources which are available to us and the historians who wrote about her, well, keep saying one the same thing. Being a priestess of the god Dionysus, the god of joy and wine, she was subject to fits of madness, which was not untypical of priests serving Dionysus at all times. And it was that madness that occurred from time to time, those fits of craziness, which were apparently a part of her nature, that were crafted on Alexander's heart and mind by his own mother, or somehow passed on to her son to become his nature. It is known that the mother and the son were very close to each other, and Alexander was raised by Olympias. She kept telling him all those great legends and myths about the legendary past of their ancestors, their forefathers, about Heracles and Achilles in the first place, developing in him the great interest in the exploits of his legendary ancestor under the walls of the city of Troy. It was since that time that Alexander developed that great affection for Achilles and that great urge to imitate him by all means, which he turned into one of the most important tasks in his life. Well, he also learned to read under the guidance of Olympias, and it is known that he knew the text of the Iliad very well, practically by heart, and kept the text of the poem that had been corrected for him by his great teacher Aristotle, the greatest Greek philosopher of the 4th century BC. He carried it on, that very text of the Iliad, with him eastward during his march against the Persians. So he loved the poem, and he loved Achilles, and he wanted desperately to be like him. So another interesting moment is the mystery that wraps the very birth of the prince, the king of Macedonia to be. But it is known again that Alexander was very often considered to be the son of Zeus. But it is interesting, because indeed it appears to be a very important part in the upbringing of a hero to be. A hero must have something divine in his nature. So very often, one of his parents was a god. That was the case with Heracles, Perseus, Theseus, and many other great Greek heroes of the past. Olympus does seem to have deliberately maintained that legend and developed it and tried to impart that secret knowledge of the real circumstances of Alexander's origins to her own son. She told him the stories which shocked him perhaps, but in the course of time he got used to hearing those stories from his mother. The stories about the love between the princess and the god Zeus himself. One of the legends says that King Philip II lost his eye when he was peeping through a keyhole into his wife's bedchamber, and it was exactly at that moment that she was making love to god Zeus, who came onto her bed in the form of a huge serpent. So when Philip II peeped through a keyhole into the bedchamber of the queen and saw her copulating with a huge serpent, well, the very fact shocked him so much that the god's punishment came quickly and handy. But he lost his eye, and for the rest of his life he was blind in one eye. So that was really interesting. Olympias said that Alexander had been conceived by god's use. I don't know whether Alexander believed in that, but very often, particularly at the later stages of his short life, he returned to that legend. He remembered it very well, and he turned it eventually into one of the most essential parts of his newly formed cult, when he was officially proclaimed the 13th god of the Olympus while being still alive. So the importance of the divine origins was highly appreciated by him, apparently. Later, it caused one of the greatest scandals between Alexander and his closest comrades in arms. One of them, Clytus, who had saved once the king's life in one of the battles when the great march against the Persians had just begun, came to the royal feast by the invitation of Alexander himself, and having seen the king drunk and hilarious in the company of his brothers-in-arms, his closest friends, well, he, being drunk himself, allowed himself some rather unwelcome comments about the king and his exploits. He quoted a couple of lines from Euripides' tragedy, saying that the Greeks were having a very bad custom when they were putting on trophies in the battlefield, being surrounded by the corpses of their dead enemies. They tend to ascribe all the glory and greatness to their kings rather than to themselves. So Alexander, having heard those lines from Euripides, got scandalized, got angered. He was really angry with Clytus because he considered him to be the one who openly insulted the king and called in question his great achievements in the presence of his closest comrades and arms. That offense could not be tolerated. Alexander was seized with a fit of madness, like his mother, and since Clytus did not bid forgiveness from the king. Alexander took a spear from one of his bodyguards and dealt a mortal blow to one of his closest friends and assistants. So Clytus was killed on the spot. Of course, later, that fit of madness gradually disappeared, and sanity returned to Alexander, and he felt very bad indeed. He was in a state of deep shock, almost paralysis. He closed himself in his royal tent for several days. He did not want to see any of his friends, anyone, even his wife, Roxana. He distanced himself from his closest assistants and companions at that time. He was even planning to kill himself. A suicide might be possible, historians say. Such a great was his feeling of sorrow because of the loss of his close friend, because of the tragedy that had occurred, since he turned out to be, well, mad at that very instant. Well, he felt really bad. He was crushed by the death of his friend and companion, but a philosopher whose name was Anaxarchus appeared in the royal tent and started talking to the king, and eventually convinced him that the fit of madness was all the will of gods, or to be more exact, the god Dionysus. Alexander asked him why. Could the philosopher explain why the god might be responsible for that tragedy? Why God was to blame? And Anaxarchus offered him quite a fascinating explanation, to my mind. He said, "Let's take a look at the circumstances that had preceded the kill. Clytus had promised to sacrifice a lamb to the god Dionysus before going to the royal feast, and the lamb had been prepared. But in the course of the preparation of that holy sacrifice on the altar of Dionysus, Clytus received an invitation from the royal tent and put it all off, which was his blunder. That was his gravest problem, that was his grossest mistake. Well, because Dionysus could not pardon him for such an insult. That was defamation. That was something like a blasphemy, something really unpardonable in the eyes of the Olympic gods, when a mortal, instead of sacrificing them what had been promised, suddenly changed his mind and decided to go aside, or to pay more attention to the pleasures of everyday life rather than serving the immortals on the Mount Olympus. So Dionysus, being the god of madness as well, decided to punish Clytus by plunging Alexander into a state of craziness, you know, just flinging him into that state when the king lost his self-control, his moderation, and allowed himself to act like a barbarian whose impulses could not be tempered, could not be ruled and regulated by reason. Aristotle had once taught his disciples in Macedonia that the major difference between a barbarian and a free Greek is that Greeks exercise moderation. They try to moderate their impulses. They try to go between and betwixt the extremes of passion and lust and everything that can hardly be controlled and which is seemingly dormant somewhere in the depth of human nature. And Alexander, being his greatest disciple, was expected to exercise that moderation, but instead he demonstrated something really barbaric, which was hardly pardonable in the eyes of his fellow Macedonians and civilized Greeks. But Anaxarchus did manage to convince him that all the blame was to be put on the god Dionysus. All the blame for the kill of Clytus was to be shifted sideways. Well, because that was indeed the case, and it helped. Well, another interesting moment, which is important for the understanding of the origins of the heroic, using the example of Alexander, is of course his relationship with his mother, of which I have said already something. Apparently, here we have what's called the classical example of the Oedipus complex. Well, the legend says that Oedipus killed his father, Laius, without ever knowing what he was doing exactly. And then he returned to Thebes and married his mother without ever knowing whom exactly he was marrying. And he had two sons and two daughters from his own mother. And everything was all right. He was the glorious king of Thebes until the moment the gods decided to punish him and his people by plague. Plague was sent to Thebes. And then everything got exposed. All the crimes of Oedipus that had been committed by him without his knowledge of what he was doing, all the crimes got exposed, and he was exiled from his own city, or left it at his own will. Well, to die blind, not very far away from Athens, where he eventually found a shelter. He was accompanied by his daughter, Antigone, who was eventually punished by her uncle, who became the king of Thebes, for the disobedience. The new king ordered the corpse of her brother to be left alone in the courtyard so that dogs could tear it apart. Well, she decided to follow the tradition, and she buried the corpse of one of her dead brothers for that crime, for the violation of the king's order. She was bricked up in a wall to die there. She was immured alive. Well, the tragic story of Oedipus is something that can be used as an instrument of a bit of psychoanalysis on my part, if we are to understand properly the nature of the relationship between Olympias and her son Alexander. But apparently their closeness had been so strong that the possibility of incest, perhaps subconscious of course, could not be excluded. Anyway, when we ask ourselves why a 20-year-old guy would be willing to go eastward with a small army that consisted of 40,000 soldiers and 20,000 horsemen, if I'm not mistaken, if my calculation is right, to take immense risks, risking his life as well as the lives of his close friends every day and every night. Well, perhaps the explanation that may be that may be tangible, you know, convincing, at least up to a certain extent, is that subconsciously he wanted to separate himself from his mother. He wanted to distance himself from her because of the great influence on her and because of the subconscious impulses of incest, which could not be excluded. His mother, Olympias, was very young. She gave birth to Alexander when she was just 16 or 17, so the difference of age between them was very small. And Alexander went away, of course. So it is very important for the understanding of another very important, important aspect of his personality, which is commented by historians very often, namely his homosexuality, or to be more exact, bisexuality. It's widely known that Alexander was married twice or thrice. He had three wives. One of them was his first wife, Proxena, or the princess of Bactria, one of the northern provinces of Persia. The other wives were taken from the Persian royal house in order to strengthen the relationship between the Macedonians and the Persians. Statira, if I'm not mistaken, is the name of one of the Persian princesses he married when he entered the city of Babylon. Well, and he did not have any children from any of them. His only son was born after the death of his father, Alexander the Fourth. That was his official name. He was a small boy when he was killed by one of Alexander's ex-friends by the name of Cassander, the tyrant of Macedonia, who was also responsible for the death of Alexander's mother and his wife Roxana. Both of them were stoned. Well, quite a painful death, I imagine. So Alexander's relationships with females were rather controversial. He did not seem to be a great fan of females, apparently. Well, historians say that he visited the tent of his Persian wife very rarely, and all of his interest lay in the relationships with his closest friend, his closest companion, commander, second in command, whose name was Hephaestion. Some controversy may be found in monographs devoted to Alexander about the true nature of their relationship. You know, some historians say that it was pure friendship, hardly having any sexual context. But most of the historians, particularly in the West, well, they're quite adamant that the relationship between Alexander and Hephaestion had a certain and strongly pronounced sexual component, because they knew each other for their lives. Well, since the beginning of their lives, practically, they had been very close, back in Macedonia, then in Persia. And Alexander considered Hephaestion to be the closest of his friends, or more like his brother. Hephaestion was a little bit older than Alexander, and deeply respected by the king. And that was the reason why he was appointed second in command in the Macedonian army during that march eastward. Plus, of course, they wanted to imitate the relations between Achilles and Patroclus, his lover boy, in the war under the walls of the city of Troy. And it is widely known that Achilles and Patroclus were lovers. So when they found themselves near the remains of the city of Troy in Asia Minor, it was the night time, and the story says that both Alexander and Hephaestion got undressed. They were stark naked, and they started running around the hill in which Achilles had been buried, allegedly, in order to commemorate him, in order to commemorate his glory, in order to express their respect and admiration to Achilles, one of the legendary forefathers of Alexander, and was very symbolic for both of them. Well, the symbolism in their relationship goes as far as the decision of Alexander to kill himself practically after the death of Hephaestion. Hephaestion died because some version says that he had been poisoned, which is probable, and another version says that he had been poisoned by some bad food, which is also probable. No one knows exactly the cause of his death. But Alexander was really beyond himself with sadness and sorrow after the death of his friend and lover. And as historians say, those 6 months that separate the death of Hephaestion and the death of Alexander was the period of most excessive drinking on the part of the king. He distanced himself from solving everyday problems, from doing everyday things as the ruler of the great empire, half of the civilized world at that time. He didn't want to get entangled in things which were apparently not very interesting to him. Well, it was more like humdrum for him, something very boring. So he was just driven mad by that sense of boredom and lack of meaning in his own life anymore. So he wanted, perhaps subconsciously, some sort of quiet suicide, and he killed himself by excessive drinking and all those endless feasts he had at that time, just to alleviate his pain a little bit, to placate himself after the death of his closest friend, just to come to terms with his loss, with the new reality of living after Hephaestion. So, in all probability, that homosexual aspect of his nature, which manifests itself so strongly in his relation with his lover and friend, is also something very important for the proper understanding of the stimuli that eventually urge him to take that extraordinary effort to become a superhuman, because in order to destroy, you should hate life. In order to feel free to destroy and create something by your own hand, something of your own, you should hate everything that surrounds you. You should not be rooted in being, as philosophers say. This is very important. I would call it some sort of a necrophilic proclivity in the nature of that potential hero. That necrophile attitude towards being, when it is easy for it to kill people, to kill living matter in en masse, to destroy kingdoms, empires, cities, towns, everything, in order to create something which would act as a monument to your own glory. So this is very important. Because an ordinary human being can't kill. Normally, it's against human nature. You have to overcome yourself. You have to overcome your weakness, your fragility, in order to take a sword and kill someone by your sword. Alexander did that in those 60 glorious battles he had during his great march. He was always in the forefront. He was among his horsemen. He was always attacking his enemy face to face. He never hid himself behind the lines of his soldiers. That was something really extraordinary to me. And in order to kill in plenty, you had to have some sort of flaw in your nature. And homosexuality explains quite a lot to me, because it excludes the possibility of replicating oneself. If you are not motivated to replicate yourself, it means that you do not like life. You do not want it to be prolonged. You do not want it to be going on and on in your descendants. So you exclude yourself from the natural flow of things, which is so clear biologically to every heterosexual. So perhaps it might be interpreted as one of the subconscious psychological factors that eventually stipulated, to a large extent, his hatred for his father on the one hand, and his readiness to kill and destroy on the other. Well, another interesting moment there is the importance of creating something new. In order to become a true hero in ancient Greece, you should not only destroy and kill, it's not enough. You have to create something as an alternative to the reality destroyed and sacrificed on the altar of your own grandeur. And if we take a close look at all those great victories of Alexander in Asia, and his ambition to reach the edge of the world to compete with Heracles and Dionysus, the two Olympic gods who, according to the legend, had reached the edge of the world and saw the great ocean that, as the Greeks believed, encircled the land populated by nations. You know, since he wanted to compete with them, since he wanted to be on a par with those immortals, well, it becomes quite clear to me why he wanted to create something that would serve as a monument to his own glory. He wanted immortality, if not in real life, since he remained to be immortal and died, as I have already said. He wanted immortality in something that would serve as a a monument to his greatness, indeed something that was to be seen by the generations to come as the living embodiment of his greatness. So his empire was a substitute object, if we are to use the Freudian terminology, partly for his love of his own mother, partly for his wish to leave something really grand and valid after his death. But, you know, to me it's really interesting to draw some parallels between Alexander and Caesar there, because Caesar was acting exactly along the same line in many ways. Well, he had taken the Roman Republic, he had destroyed the democracy of the Roman Republic. Instead, he laid the crowns for the Roman Empire and became, some historians say, the first real Roman emperor. And then he died. Plus, he had the same sort of intense and rather intricate relationship with his own mother, so the parallels there are very interesting. Plus, of course, the fact that Alexander did not have children, so he was not motivated to have children. Well, it could be explained by his homosexuality, of course, but Caesar also had just one daughter, Julia, who died at a very early age, and Caesarion, the son from Cleopatra, the queen of Egypt, who was killed by his stepson, who was to become Emperor Augustus a little bit later. So it is a certain similarity in the lives of those two great heroes that makes it possible for me to assume that the relationship between a son and a mother on the one hand and the ambition to leave something really grand after your human life on the other, well, being combined, create that impulse of the heroic that eventually turns a man into a god. Well, Alexander turned out to be rather active in the creation of the new world that was to come after the destroyed reality associated with the previous generations and his father in the first place, with whom, to whom he had always been apparently a great rival. So he founded 18 Alexandrias throughout his empire. And the greatest Alexandria was, of course, in Egypt, the great cradle of the Hellenic civilization, the seat of the great library that contained about 800,000 scrolls, manuscripts. Sadly, it was destroyed in fire. And the museum that was the heart of the Hellenic cultural world at that time, the place where philosophers, mathematicians, philologists, people of all kinds working in different fields of arts realized their ambitions and polished their talents up. All of those great contributions into the history of Europe and the world made by Alexander, of course, were considered to be something really extraordinary by his contemporaries, those people who lived after him, and he remains to be one of the cult figures in European history. So perhaps he reached his goal. I said that while he was still alive, he was proclaimed to be the 13th god of the Olympus. Of course, he died 3 weeks away from his 33rd birthday in Babylon, and his empire began to crumble right after his death. But all the empires are covered with the dust of time, because time does not take pity on anyone. Ashes to ashes, as the Bible says, but the legend of Megas Alexandros, the greatest of all, well, remains to be very much alive. And perhaps that's the intrigue. The intrigue lies in the fact that a man could overcome himself, overcome the limitations of his nature, the borders of the appropriate, ordinary, and common. A man could realize his ambitions in the freest way possible. A man could acquire that unprecedentedly high extent of freedom, which is something that causes envy in many ordinary ones like ourselves. The man who could manage to create something really grand, conquering half of the civilized world at that time and turning himself into the master of those vast territories. He did found a lot of cities. He stimulated the development of culture and arts. So he left quite a long-lasting legacy. So in a way, he reached the greatest and most remarkable of his goals. He became divine in the memory of the generations to come. So here comes out the mystery of the heroic. It is through the overcoming, through the painstaking endeavor, through the creation of something really unprecedented, something that did not exist before, that a man could become someone else, a new entity, someone much closer to the divine, someone much closer to immortality, if not in real life, but at least in the hearts and minds of his descendants. That's it. Well, today I'm not going to read any poetry because I couldn't find any good poem about Alexander. Нет хорошего стиха, плохой читать не хочется. Я уже было хотел сам сочинить стих, но потом передумал. Ну и сколько получилось?
Зря.
Чего? Без стиха? Ну я вам могу рассказать по-русски только тот стих, который я сочинил для Семёна. Хотите, запишите, если понравится, подмонтируйте. Он на самом деле подходит, отчасти, по крайней мере. Да. Ну и давайте. Спасибо, Господи, за то, какие мы, за наши тайные и явные пороки, людей, роднящие сознание вины, лишь в нем единственном мы все не одиноки, за то, что наша совесть нечиста, она цена отказа от свободы. Но на покрове белолицего Христа заметны грязноватые разводы, за редкую и режущую боль, апофеоз обряда приобщения, сносить которую мы все готовы, коль ей обусловлены секунды наслаждения, за то, что нам приходится скрывать, подчас пока пыл не погасит старость, греха стыдиться, значит признавать, что в жизни больше смысла не осталось.